Today we're finishing Descartes. So let's think a little bit about where we started and where Descartes was trying to go. We spent last class talking a lot about God, and we're going to talk a little bit about God this class, but now we're going to talk a little bit more about the human being himself or herself or itself. Where did Descartes start off? What was his first worry that he had in Meditation 1? What was the first thing he got concerned about? What to call his new book? No, it wasn't that. What was he concerned about? This will put it all in perspective. He was worried about whether he was accurate about something, whether he was in touch with something. What was it? Do you remember? There were a lot of things he was worried about in Meditation 1, but what was the first thing he got not upset, but interested in figuring out?
If God exists or not, like, no.
Well, that'll come a little bit later. He is interested in whether God exists. Not it seems, because Descartes is really into God or anything like that.
What our senses?
Yes. So, if we're mind and body, or spirit and body, or soul and body, whatever you want to call it, the external world that we perceive, we're perceiving through our senses. You're hearing me right now, right? Somebody watching this video would be hearing, seeing things through their eyes, through their ears. It's not going directly into their brain. You know, we don't have that sort of capability. sometimes our senses are wrong, right? What are some of those cases? You know, the stick that goes in the wall, we all know it's not actually changing its configuration, right? You see the mirage as you're driving in the hot summer, and it looks like it's water, but it's not actually water. But then he's got a bigger worry. What if this is all in a dream? That's a bigger worry than just, you know, am I fooled once in a while? That's sort of like saying, am I in a perpetual magic show where somebody else is screwing with me all the time, deceiving me? Or maybe I'm deceiving myself. Maybe I'm actually insane. And this is all just some sort of nightmare. I'm really in an asylum somewhere. Or I'm hallucinating. Or I'm in somebody else's dream. Or, you know, there was actually a movie like this fairly recently. Maybe I'm a character in somebody's novel. There's all sorts of possibilities. And all of those put the external world into doubt. They even put, if we go far enough with them, they put our body into doubt. Maybe we don't actually have bodies. Maybe we're all just disembodied souls in somewhere, or we're glitches in a computer program, or, you know, who knows. So what we want to do, if we're good Cartesians, first we want to doubt, and then we want to put the world back together. Why does he stop at God on the way? Doesn't that seem like kind of a strange move to make? If your whole goal is to get to the external world, and things in the external world, why bring up God? Well, first let's think about some of the things in the external world that we care about. So what are some of the things here in this room? Just look around.
Computers.
Yeah, and so computers, we've got this chair right here, right? Coffee cups. Pens, chalk. Now these are all what we call, what, objects, right? And we want to know about them. I mean, I would like to think that this is not just some sort of, you know, program in a larger computer program that I'm experiencing right now. When I go and eat dinner, I don't want to think that I'm in the Matrix and I'm eating fake whatever it is that we're having for dinner. I'm not even sure yet, because we haven't planned very well for the week. What else is in the world? What else is in this classroom besides just plain old objects? Something more important, something more valuable. It's not knowledge, although that's in the classroom, but where would the knowledge be? Human beings. We're interested in other human beings. And other human beings, likewise, other people, we know other human beings? Do we have a direct mind-to-mind connection? How do you know me? Through my body, right? Through what you hear, see, feel. How do you know anybody else in this classroom? Through their body, through your senses. You are perceiving them. You don't have direct access to my mind or my soul any more than I do to you. We have signs of this. When I assign you a paper and I say, I want to see that you understand this, demonstrate it to me. How do you do it? You actually put it, well, you don't write it out by hand, probably, any of you. You're all in the computer generation, so you type it out on your computer. But that's physical, right? How do you know that any of that stuff really exists? Wouldn't it be terrible to find out you're the only actual human being in the world? And all these other people just made up something that God or some sadistic demon has put in your way just to screw with you?
Wouldn't that make you fake? Because that's the way it would seem to everybody else.
Well, those everybody else wouldn't be real people, would they?
How do you know you are then?
Well, that's where we... Okay, so now we're going along the process, right? That's where we have the cogito. If this is one thing that I can say about myself and you can say about yourself and Descartes can say about himself, I have to exist. If I'm being deceived, there has to be a me to be deceived. So even if I am, say, just somebody's figment of their imagination, I do exist. I have some reality. I am a substance. Whether other people are that or not, Descartes says you can't be sure about that yet. We're still in the hyperbolic doubt. We haven't gotten to that point yet. So what could give us the possibility of real knowledge? Well, let's think about God for a minute. Descartes ended up trying to prove that God exists. And maybe you accept his proof, maybe you don't. We're not so much interested in whether you individually accept that proof or not, or find it convincing. We're interested in what mileage is Descartes trying to get out of it. And what do you remember about what he thinks about God? He thinks God exists, right? What does he think God is? What does he call God? What are the terms that he uses, or the characteristics that God has? Go ahead. That was Anselm, right? Descartes is doing something a little bit different. Descartes actually, like I pointed out last class, says something about God that Anselm says, I'm not using that in my argument. Of course, I think about God, but I'm not saying that God is this when I'm trying to argue for it. What do you say God was? He's not very different than other theist philosophers who believe that God exists. Is God good or bad? Thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
Yeah, he says God is actually good. He's all good. What else do you know about him? He's infinitely powerful.
Did you say he's the prime mover? Is that what Descartes said, or is that something else?
Descartes—that's Aristotle, and that's Thomas Aquinas. But that's okay.
Does he agree with that?
Does Descartes agree that God is the prime mover? Yeah, he thinks that God created everything. Once he creates it, he sort of leaves it alone. Descartes' God doesn't do an awful lot. He preserves things in being. Right?
See, I could agree with that.
Oh yeah, I think that you could be a deist and go along with what Descartes says. Or probably Aristotle, too. Aristotle's God is not very involved in human affairs. But they have him there to get everything going, somewhat in different ways. Descartes is less interested in the metaphysics, what got everything going, and more interested in can we know anything for certain. And this is where the goodness comes in. Since God is good, God is not going to be a deceiver. Because to deceive people, that's bad, right? In general. I mean, if you wanted to kill all your classmates and you came in here with a gun and I said, hey, look over there, there's a monster. I'd be telling a lie, right? But I might distract you long enough that one of us could jump on you and take the gun away. And would that be a bad deception? That would be a good deception, right? But God's not in those sort of situations. I mean, the omnipotence thing kind of takes care of that, doesn't it? So if God is, you know, just screwing with us, setting things up for us to always fail epistemologically in terms of knowledge, God wouldn't be God. God would be something like that evil demon that Descartes was hypothesizing about. If God is supremely perfect, God's not going to be a deceiver. So what's the upshot of that for knowledge? That means that some of our knowledge of the external world and the way it works could be reliable. So for Descartes, if you can't prove that God exists, or you can't assume that God exists, or you don't have something like God in the picture, you can't really know anything with certainty. But once you've got God in the picture, now you can start building everything back up. Do you guys see how these fit together? Now, one of the things I want to point out to you with this, Descartes has been accused of engaging in a circular argument. You guys know what a circular argument is? What's a circular argument?
One that can be solved.
Well,
it keeps repeating itself.
The argument itself doesn't repeat itself, but the parts, the way they're arranged in relation to each other, one part is required to prove another part, but that part is being proved by the first one. I'll give you an example. Again, with God, right? Some people say, God exists. How do you know that? Well, the Bible says so. There we go. Okay, what's the problem with that? Does everybody agree that, well, if it's in the Bible, it must be true? You have to back that up by saying the Bible is true, right? And then usually if you say, how do you know the Bible's true? Well, God wrote it, right? So it must be true, and it says in there that God exists, so God must exist, which is what you need in order to think that the Bible's true, and it just keeps going in one big circle like that, right? Now, these things could be true. These all could actually be true statements. That's not the bad part of the argument. The bad part is that the way the argument is set up, it's a big circle. What Descartes actually needs is something that you might say is in the external world, or maybe it's in our minds, that things that we actually perceive as clear and distinct are actually true, or we can have knowledge about that. Because think about when he tried to prove God's existence. There was an important point that I stressed to you where he was making an assumption about causes and effects. Do you remember that? He made the assumption that if you have an effect, the cause has to have at least as much reality as the effect. Now, how did he know that? Didn't he doubt everything? Do you remember in the meditations him proving that principle to you? He just kind of brought it in, didn't he? Maybe you didn't catch that the first time through. Or maybe the second time, or the third time, however many times that you read it. Bless you. There's a lot in these texts that I don't catch, you know, the first or 10 times that I read them. If you have to assume some principles that are out there in the world or in the universe that a good God would have created, and you need those to prove that God exists, then there's something like a circularity there, isn't there? They call this the Cartesian circle. But if you accept it, and let's say we get past that, what Descartes talks about are clear and distinct ideas. Anything that I can have clear and distinct ideas of, where I really understand it, and I've broken it down into its bits, that I can have knowledge of. So God's not a deceiver. I do seem to know some things about the world, about mathematics, about causality, about metaphysics. I can trust those things, Descartes is saying. Maybe even I can even get to other people. I could say, you know, if the cogito works for me, it works for them too. Descartes doesn't go there. He's not that worried about that. We're probably more worried about that than he is. But that's something worth thinking about. Now this sets up kind of a problem. So if God is good, and God exists, and God set up everything, and I now have a way in which I can tell whether I'm on track with things, how is it possible that I ever get deceived? How is it possible that I've been taken in by things? And this is where he gets to another distinction. And we've talked a little bit about the will before, but the will is going to be very, very important in the rest of the meditations. When we talk about your will, what do we mean? All of you have a will. It's part of what got you here today. I don't mean like a will, like, you know, in your safety deposit box about, you know, what's going to happen to your books or your car or things like that. I mean part of you. What is your will? Or if we say you have free will, what does that mean? Yeah.
Choice to do what you want.
You have the capacity to choose, right? You have choices, but if you were like a robot, it wouldn't matter whether you had choices. Like a robot could, you know, walk this way or walk that way, but its programming tells it you have to go this way. You're not like that, are you? You're unique among animals. Other animals have wills, but they're not free wills. Like a dog, you know, does it have a choice whether it loves its puppies or not? That's instinct. We kind of look at them as if they have a free will the way that we do. But, you know, dogs are pretty conditioned. And they're pretty simple animals. Even you know, it gets debatable when we get to chimpanzees and things like that. But all of you have a free will. As a matter of fact, let's say that you realize something about yourself that you don't like. Something about your behavior. Something that, you know, things that you've chosen to do so far. What are your options then? What do people do in those sort of circumstances? You realize that you're too mean to people, or that you take people for granted, or take more than your fair share of the cake when it's given to you. What sort of things do you do? You've all done something, you've all dealt with something like this in your lifetime. You've changed your habits. What do you do? Yeah?
You have to, like, rebuild your relationships with people and, like, bring back really respect and trust.
Yeah, if it's a relationship matter and relationships are damaged, you have to do work. And who chooses whether you do that work?
You do,
right, yeah. You have the freedom to change the course of your will. If your habits are making you go this way, and you want to change it, you have the freedom to actually say, hey, this is the wrong way, I need to start going this way. Although, usually what happens is you're going this way, and then you say, I got to change this, and you're now going still this way, right, for a while, and then you finally change your habits and you're going the right way. Your will is really interesting. It has the capacity not only to judge everything out there in the universe and to make your body do what it wants, your will has the capacity to make itself do what it wants. And even if you feel like you're not making a choice, you still make a choice. If you have a difficult decision to make, and you say, I'm going to put it off until tomorrow, that's a choice, right? If you say, I can't decide at all, I'm going to let somebody else decide. You decided to let somebody else decide, didn't you? That's your will. Nothing else in the universe is like that, except for maybe God. You have what we call radical freedom. This is why this is such an exciting time for you guys, because you get to choose the person that you're going to become. When you get to be my age, you can still change yourself, but it's a bit harder. Certainly the body is a lot harder to change, but even the mental habits, you know. If I decide, okay, I'm going to be a morning person from now on, which I'm not, I could do that. It would take an awful lot of willing over and over again to change the way that I typically do things, to change my choices that I make. So you have this capacity of will, and it's basically infinite, Descartes says. The only thing that can constrain your will, ultimately, is your will. If somebody holds a gun to your head and says, give me your money, remember we talked about this with Aristotle, right? Somebody holds a gun to your head and says, we're going to the ATM, you're going to take all your money out. Could you refuse? Could you say, screw you, I'm not going to do it? Yeah, you have that choice. You have the capacity to do that. Any one of you here at Marist can choose to study anything you want, right? I mean, you know, there will be repercussions. If you decide to study physics and you're not good at math, you're going to have a hard time, right? If you go into fashion merchandising and you really hate, you know, magazines like Cosmo and Marie Claire, you're going to have a rough time. But you do have the choice. And anything that you want to know that's in that library over there, nothing's stopping you. Nothing could stop you. If you choose to do it, you at least have the capacity to choose. You don't necessarily determine whether it's going to be successful or not, but you have the capacity to choose anything you want. If you want to think about something, you can choose that too. If you even want to think that true things are false and false things are true, you can make yourself do that. If you want to believe that all politicians are liars and cheats and stuff like that, that can't possibly be true, but you could make yourself believe that. Or if you want to make yourself believe, some of you are coughing, my grandparents' generation, you know what they used to do when they were kids to deal with coughs? They gargle with kerosene. Sounds kind of crazy, right? But you could think that that's true. You could make yourself think that that's true if you worked at it hard enough. Don't know why you'd want to do it, but you could make yourself do that. And you could make yourself gargle with kerosene if you wanted to. You have the capacity to will all these things. So your will is, as Descartes says, pretty much infinite. What about the rest of your mind? Is your imagination infinite? Can you imagine anything that you possibly want to? Maybe. I find my imagination rather constrained. There are some things I can't imagine. Like Descartes talks about a thousand-sided figure. Can you call up a thousand-sided figure in your mind? Sort of like a pentagon is a five-sided figure and a hexagon is a six-sided figure. Call up a thousand-sided figure in your mind. Can you do that? Probably not. I mean, you could make like something that has a whole bunch of angles, but how do you know it's a thousand unless you actually count them? Well, that means that your imagination is restricted, isn't it? What about your senses? Can you perceive everything? Actually, you don't perceive most of the things that go on around you. Most of what we take in through our senses, we filter out. Otherwise, we'd go insane. One of the reasons why researchers think that autistic kids are less interested in human beings and therefore lack social skills is because they're so interested in the things that they're actually seeing or experiencing. They're taking in more sense data than we are. And they're fascinated by it. They're almost, you might say, imprisoned by it, right? What about your intellect, your understanding, the thing that's like the highest part of you? Is that infinite? Do any of you like know everything like God does offhand? Will any of you ever know everything that God does? Or let's set the bar a lot lower, right? I mean, who can compete with God? Who's the smartest person you can think of offhand? Like maybe a celebrity or somebody we know about. Anybody. Who's the smartest person you can think of? Could be somebody on TV. Anyone you want. Surely you must have some ideas about who's smart, right? Who do you watch and you say, wow, that person's really bright? All of you watch TV, right? Anybody here who doesn't watch TV? You don't watch TV at all?
Not really.
Not really or not at all?
Pretty much not at all. I want to explore some time.
Okay, who's a smart sports person? Who gets paid to sit up there and chew the fat about, you know, why the Bears won and how it's bad that Jay Cutler got his thumb broken or whatever it is that happened to him? I mean, this is kind of a good example of your intellects not being unlimited anyway. If you can't bring to mind somebody who you think is smart, clearly there's some gaps in your intellect so far. Could you fill all those in? What do you think? How do you feel about this? I mean, you guys are students. This is your whole job right now, is to sort of improve your intellects. Sure, you know, prepare yourself for a career and all that, but really what they're going to hire you for is your brains. They're not going to hire you for your winning personality, your good looks, your great connections or stuff like that. That may help you get a job, but what's going to keep you in that job in today's workplace is being on the ball. How smart could you get? What do you think? How smart should a student be when they get out of Marist? Let me ask that question. What do you think you should know? Besides answers to questions that I keep throwing at you. What else, what's important for you guys to master? What do you think? You were going to say something. What do you think is important for you to master?
A major.
Yeah, okay. I think that's a good place to start, right? If you get out of here and you're majoring in something and you don't know anything about it, when you get done, something happened that didn't, you know, didn't go right. Your intellect, your mind should be greatly improved by the time that you get out of here. You should at least know about whatever it is that you're supposed to be passionate about studying. Will that help you know about everything? What if you spent all your time in that library? And I mean all your time. All you did was come to class, go back to your dorm, sleep, go to the cafeteria, eat, and then everything else is spent in that library. You'd learn a lot, right? Would you be much closer to like infinite knowledge? I always get depressed when I go to the library. You know why? Because I've been reading my whole life. I've been reading since I was like 3. And I've been studying philosophy since I was like 16 or so. And I walk down like, you know, one stack of philosophy books and I'm like, I'm never going to have the chance to even read most of these and know what's going on in them, let alone, you know, the ones that I read actually figure out what's in the book and follow along with it, and then remember it the next week after I put the book down. To me, that's kind of depressing. That means that I'm very, very restricted. Maybe you guys, you know, you're earlier along, maybe you'll overcome that. But still, our intellects are very limited, aren't they? So if our intellect is limited, but our will isn't, that has certain ramifications. You can believe things, you can choose to believe things, or you can choose to take a position on things, what Descartes calls a judgment, without actually knowing it. So when you were having a dream and you thought your dream was real, what was going on there? Your intellect, all the intellect does is has ideas. It doesn't actually tell you that those ideas are true or false or anything like that. It just has ideas and they're put together in certain ways. It's your will that comes out and says, yes, this is real, or no, this is not real. This is true, this is false. So if you allow your will to outstrip your intellect, if you allow it to go beyond what you actually understand with clear and distinct ideas, then you're going to have trouble. Then you're going to believe things that aren't true. So let's think for a minute just about some examples of this. They don't have to be Cartesian examples. Think about your day-to-day life. How many of you have been in a relationship, you know, like in the last year, had a boyfriend or girlfriend or whatever you want to call them? I don't know. People have other names for the, you know, that sort of thing these days. Friend with benefits, significant other, whatever, right? How do you know that they weren't cheating on you?
You don't.
Yeah.
I mean, you trust them.
Okay, so when you trust somebody, you are making a choice, right? Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't. I'm just saying what Descartes would say. Unless you actually know, you shouldn't commit yourself. So your attitude towards the boyfriend, girlfriend would be, you know, so far I haven't found any evidence that they've cheated on me. I'm open to, you know, revising my thing one way or the other. There's probably no way that anybody could ever convince you that they would never cheat on you, other than maybe going through a lot of tests. What about products? You guys eat a lot of things, right? Drink a lot of different things. How many of you buy groceries? Any of you buy groceries at this point? No? You all eat in the cafeteria? Or when you're going home, you're going to eat, you know, at Mom and Dad's or Uncle Sam's or whoever's place you're going to. So how do you know that food is healthy? You believe it is, right? You don't think anyone's giving you bad food, right? Or do you think the cafeteria is giving you bad food? I don't know. Have you gone, you know, looked around and seen what they put in the food? You know, looked at the cans and boxes and see, you know, what the ingredients are? We had gyros today in the cafeteria. Make your own gyros thing. That's always kind of iffy, because gyros is pressed meat. What's it supposed to be? It's supposed to be beef and lamb, right? You don't know it's beef and lamb, do you? Might be cat. Might be, you know, soybeans. Who knows? Not a type of meat, right? But they use soy to fill out meat. How do you actually know? If you don't know, Descartes would say, don't say that you know. Just say, I think it might be this way, but I don't really know. Adopt a sort of intellectual humility or skepticism about things. If you do that, Descartes says, then you're not going to find yourself believing in things that turn out later on to be false. You're never going to be deceived. You actually have the choice. This is what you might call an ethics of the use of the mind. Now, the question would be, do you actually want to live that way? Would you like to look at other beings out in the, you know, the world and say, well, I don't know that Mr. Roth is not actually an android. Can't be completely sure. I'm just going to, you know, treat him as if he's not, for the time being, and withhold my assent. I don't know. Would you want to live like that? Descartes thought that was the way to go. He thought that's better than believing in a lot of things that you don't actually know are true. What can you be sure about that? Well, Descartes says, there are some things in the external world that you can't actually be pretty sure about. And he's got this idea about what he calls, and this is in Meditation 5, he calls them true and immutable natures. So objects, true and immutable natures. think about geometry, for example. You guys all remember high school geometry. It's probably pretty boring because you did a lot of proofs if it was like my geometry class. So you forgot most of what you learned there because it was actually boring and you don't remember what was boring, right? What were you actually dealing with there? You were dealing with the basic building blocks of physical reality. Triangles, circles, those sorts of things. Lines, planes, all of that. Those things have certain natures. That's why we can teach a geometry class. That's why we can have the same, you know, results over and over and over again. How do you know that a triangle not only has three angles, but that those three angles add up to 180 degrees? You probably don't remember any proofs about that, right? Does anyone in here remember that? I don't. But I believe it. Why do I believe it? I think that's part of the essence of what it is to be a triangle. Do you? Or do you think maybe triangles have 176 degrees? Or maybe they vary. Maybe they can have whatever you want. Anyone in here think that? Well, if you think about the nature of a triangle, and you don't actually have to look at triangles of a world to do this, so again, why we can do geometry, you can actually consult things in your mind. These true and immutable natures are actually in your mind. They're what Descartes calls, or they correspond to what Descartes calls, innate ideas. Ideas that you are born with. You don't start thinking about triangles as soon as you're, you know, born or anything like that. These ideas have to be actuated. They have to have something, you know, call them to mind. This is kind of similar to Plato, isn't it? And the idea of the forms. Except these are actually in your mind, and you're born with them. He talks about your mind as being something like a treasury or a storehouse. It's got all these ideas in it just waiting for you to start using them. Mathematics, all of those ideas are in your mind. Geometry, all of those things are in your mind. Metaphysics, those are in your mind as well. It's just up to you to actually find them and start using them and become familiar with them. Now, what do you think that would take to do that? There's really two things. One is not tying yourself into projects, believing in things that may or may not be true. The other thing is to try to get your mind away from the body. Don't think of things in terms of their external appearances. Think of things in terms of their structures, their intelligible structures. Again, sounds sort of like Plato, sounds sort of like Aristotle, doesn't it? The more that you do that, the better you'll get at it. Just like the more that you do mathematics, the better you get at it, right? Or the more that you do athletics with the physical things, the better you get at it. So this is what we call an aesthesis. We have two things. We have an ethics of the use of the mind, how you ought to be using your mind. And we have what we call an aesthesis. You might think of it as a workout program. That's what the meditations, in effect, are. A sort of workout program for your mind to help you see things in certain ways. Ways that are more true in Descartes' view. And if you do that, then you will never be deceived again. You'll never give assent to things that aren't true. And you won't even worry about whether you're in a dream or not. Because Descartes, by the time we get to the end of this, thinks there are some signs by which we can tell we're actually not in a dream. So what do you guys, this is where we'll end. We'll actually end a little bit early today. What do you make of all this Descartes business? When you're reading the meditations, did any of you walk away from here worried that we were stuck in a dream? Sometimes there is a student that happens to. What can you take from this? What do you find that's maybe useful for you? what did you find interesting in Descartes? That's a good place to end the...
That you can't really believe what you see or like hear because your senses don't always, they're not always accurate.
Yeah, that's true. Now, Descartes's not unique in saying that. He's maybe unique in how far he goes with that.
Being more skeptical, I guess, of what's around you.
Yeah.
Instead of just kind of believing what you see and everything like that.
The funny thing is, once you start doing that, it becomes all... There's a sort of risk. You start becoming skeptical of one thing, then you start doubting more and more and more and more. What else? Anything else that struck you in reading through this stuff? What do you think you're going to remember about Descartes 2 years from now, 10 years from now? I'm always interested in that. Because I know I'm going to remember him, you know, because I do this for a living. But I'm really interested in what you guys are going to remember. Yeah.
It's just, like, interesting how much we trust people and what we know, like, we shouldn't.
Yeah, we don't think that much about it, do we?
Yeah, we just go ahead and trust someone.
Yeah. That's the way our everyday life is. I'm not saying, by the way, that you should go home and, you know, start distrusting the turkey or worrying about if there's anything in the stuffing or anything like that. But yeah, you're right. It's a sort of what we call the natural attitude, this habit of just sort of naively trusting things. Descartes gets us out of that. He gets us maybe too far into skepticism, but then he brings us back out of it. What would happen if you took God out of the picture with this? What if, instead of it being God, we're looking at like a computer, like in the Matrix? Could you ever trust anything then, other than the fact that you exist and you have these perceptions and that sort of stuff? You know, think about the Matrix movie. This is where I'll actually leave you. You guys are all familiar with this, right? So he takes which does he take, the red pill or the blue pill? Anyone remember?
Blue, I think.
Blue takes you down the rabbit hole?
The finger hole.
Okay, and then there's the scene where they pull him out of the thing, so now he's no longer plugged into the Matrix. He's actually in his physical body, and his consciousness is connected with it. But couldn't that all just be like in one bigger computer program? Once you take out the assumption that your perceptions could be relied on because there's some sort of... It doesn't necessarily have to be God. It could be the universe is designed in such a way as it makes sense or it's intelligible. You could take God out of the picture. But if you don't have that assumption, then you could never really be sure about anything, could you? That, by the way, is the world of the paranoiac. The person who's got, you know, paranoiac personality disorder. They think that everybody's out to get them or that some people are out to persecute them. Once you fall into that, it's very difficult to get out. So, have a good Thanksgiving.